Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Global Lecture Hall for today's lectures. Also, today we are also broadcasting from Madrid, and as usual, several other places from the guest lectures. I would say, as usual, we have a quite interesting program. So first, I will follow into the main line of the general information, which is mainly based on the book from Rolf and Josh, which will give a lecture today. After the coffee break, we will have a presentation from Josh Bongard at 10:20 on the evolution of morphological complexity. You will see it's a very interesting work. Then, in a similar path, but if you want, at a different level of complexity, we will have a recorded talk from Giorgio Metta on developing intelligence in the humanoids. So a characteristic of the ICAB humanoids is that actually is more considered as a wind tunnel for the study of cognition than more than a mechatronic system. And then we will finish on the same line, which today is essentially learning and development, with a talk from Yasuo Kuniyoshi from the University of Tokyo on the idea of having embodied intelligence as a learning process co-evolving with the development process. So it will be, I think that we have several lectures, but today they are particularly well connected with each other. Actually, Giorgio was supposed to connect live, but he couldn't because he had a sudden business meeting in Brussels or somewhere, so he couldn't avoid to go. And so the next, where we are into the program, we are almost to the end. So I would say that this is the last of the main thread, and then in the next one we will have a summary lecture by Rolf, which will focus on the main issue of the whole story. And this is the, we after that we are the only one that we is out is the next one which we will also be extremely interesting and stimulating as is our habit. I leave the presentations of the people when I will introduce the lecture, and I pass to the to today topic, today's topic of my lecture. So the title is extremely ambitious, but all the lecture series is somehow ambitious, as we are actually trying to refine a new paradigm approach to both AI and what is traditionally called as AI and robotics in the frame of embodied intelligence. A short recap of the previous episodes. No? So which is our starting point? Our starting point is that we know that AI is very successful in manufacturing, in chess, in Google. We use every day Google. And we know there are limitations. So the behavior and simple things like grasping an object seem very difficult exercise. The other thing that we know is that we have so far followed a paradigm which is based on top-down control, is based on a very precise control of, for instance, of a welding arm, which is appropriate for that application, but not for every application. And we have observed that in nature we have a completely different approach, no? Based on multi-agent emergence and so on and so forth. So the problem is how, if I want to stay out of the Dennett limitation, no? This kind of growing complexity that every time that I want to manage a new chair, I need to touch the software into the robot. How I can let the symbols emerge, no? So the idea is to grow them to make them grow to self-organize from the flow of a sensory stimulation. We have seen several criteria, and we have also seen that also for sensing, the morphology is important. We have questioned, for instance, the fact that memory itself require a symbolic system, no? Because memory, for instance, the shape of a fountain we observed is not stored, no? It is in the structure of a hydraulics, if you want, and the geometry of a fountain. And so the problem now is from where the symbols come from. And we have seen that some symbols are probably not needed, like in the example of a fountain, and that other symbols are, if you want, it was clear, for instance, in the presentation that we had from Angelo Cangelosi, or the presentation that we had from Kevin O'Regan, for giving an example. So actually, there is no need to really carve this symbol. We can let them emerge. From what? So we need to have a distribution of a task and we pass from the top-down control, which means I tell the system what to do at every level, to an orchestrating control, which means that according to what happens, some parameters are changed. And then, so the first stage is that to pass from the flow to having some sensory motor coordination, to having we have seen how there are potentially some tool to do that, like measuring some metrics related to the information which in between actuators and sensors, so how the system is able to predict the future value of the actuators. We have seen this paper from Lungarella and Sporns. We have quoted the fact that this could also drive the self-organization of behaviors, maybe with some mathematical sophistication, like considering the fact that the mobility space of a real physical structure is not all the possible value, but only the value that I can have in this physical structure. This is the meaning of that mathematically translates to having not a not Euclidean space, but in practice what we say is, no, I cannot do everything. I can do what my arm allows me to do and what my dynamics allow me to know. And we see as this was proposed by Fumiya Ida. Actually, the attractors and the dynamics of Puppy, which is a kind of iconic example of a robot inspired by our vision, could be, for instance, the attractors in the dynamics of the system. And some of you will know that the attractors are something which is well defined from the dynamical system theory. So how we go forward from there, no? Because we see that we can actually abstract something from the sensory motor flow, but there is a long way from abstracting something from my sensory motor coordination to me demonstrating Pythagoras' theorem or something more sophisticated, no? So it's really possible to do this long path. So, for instance, the meaning of the Kirsch-Brooks debate was that actually Kirsch was questioning that this idea of a sensory of abstraction of creating structure on the sensory motor flow could really lead to what usually is studied by artificial intelligence. We will just quote because we don't have much time, but actually someone has given at least some concrete example of the fact that even the abstract ideas like the limit of a function could be in our being of human people studying mathematics could actually be based on some motor knowledge, no? Sensory motor. So actually, when I do and do the limit of this function for t which goes to infinite, you see that I'm actually thinking of moving. And the interesting thing is that there are some experiments that show that actually, if you look in my brain, I am actually activating parts, so I'm actually moving. And this was from Lakoff and Nunez. And now, just to give an idea, we can show the video on the swarm of birds. Because what is interesting in this example is that you will see, so this is a kind of collective behavior which is based on very simple rules, no? Keeping the distance and keeping aligned with your neighbor. And on the basis of this, you have this kind of extremely complicated, complex behaviors. And I mean, it's another aspect of the Simon Saint on the beach. So you see something extremely complex, but the rules which actually regulate from which this extremely complex behavior emerge are simple. Now, as I told you, is more or less keeping the distance from your neighbor and keeping alignment with your neighbors. And this is what come out from it. In fact, if we go look to the next video. My favorite, if you want. So the underlying idea, so what you may think is that this could be a more regulated and more complex version of a swarm that we saw before. So the idea is how this kind of collective intelligence emerge, no? Because what we are actually trying to synthesize is are kind of system of this kind. No? So the swarm, which is a kind of emerging coordination and emerging behavior of a huge number of agents, could be a simple version, a simplified version, or of what happens in a cell or even in a multicellular body, like an animal. Of course, probably with much more complication in the rules, but probably not as much complication as we would put into a system if you want to detail all the possible conditions in which the system should find itself and all the things that it should do it should do to react to the different condition where it can happen. So the idea is that what allows me to have complex behaviors, maybe also kind of symbolic or proto-symbolic, so kind of symbolic intelligence should come from learning, no? And then if we look at biology, no? Because the point is that we don't want you may have different approaches to Sometimes you use different words for that. Now, bio-mimicking and bio-inspiration, for instance. We are more on the, we are not going to copy nature. Our aim, and it was also apparent in the talk from Luigi Luisi next week, what we really aim is to understand the rules and the principle and to use them to build artifacts with similar characteristics. And we observed that this is the idea of a synthetic methodology approach. No? So, I mean, a real cell is now a very sophisticated system, which comes from a very long history. No? Because if you look, and so we should do something more simple. If you look to nature, actually, we an extremely important aspect is that when we learn something, for instance, we learned our mother language, but we didn't invent our mother language. This was already there. So this means that it's not only me learning Italian or English or something other language. It's someone there was already a previous evolution. So at least, and this is the case of humans, which have a social, also we have more complexities than the other animals, or at least we believe we have more, the other animals have a much more simple social interaction, so they don't, they are not supposed to have cultures, no? Although you may know that for dolphins, it seems that at least they have dialects and local good practice that they transmit from generation to generation. So something similar to what I was quoting now. So the time perspective is important because there is my learning, but actually my arm was not evolved during my development, was already there. This was the phylogenetic level, so the level at which the evolution defined the characteristics of the different organisms. And then, actually, this arm is an adult arm, maybe almost an old person arm. Before having this arm, I had a smaller one. And many years ago, I had a very, very, very small one. And even before you and me were more or less floating in the womb, no? So in a liquid, viscous liquid, equipped with a kind of starship environment. So we have at least in animals, which are our paradigmatic example of success in building robots, if you want, we have at least three different levels of learning and development. So we have a level of a species, we have a level of a single individual which grows, and so learn while it grows, and so the physical change is mutually adapted to the thinking structure, to the intelligence of a system. So actually Kevin was observing, talking about consciousness, was observing that we may be conscious in a different way than a 5 years old baby, child, and we may, could be even different, the consciousness of a 3 months old baby. So we really don't know. So, we don't know. What we know is that in the ontogenetic development goes together, and it is mutually influenced by the learning. What does it mean in practical terms, if you want to mimic it on a robot? We will see in some of the next, especially in Kuniyoshi's presentation. But I will come back to on this when we introduce the speaker. So actually already Turing, which I did much more than people usually think, observed that if we want, so I read, allow me this, you can read yourself, but because I think that it's really well written. No? So it's, instead of trying to produce a program to simulate the adult mind, why not radar try to produce one which simulates the child? So it's obvious, no? The child should be less intelligent. If this were then subjected to an appropriate course of education, one would obtain the adult brain. So in the 50s, Turing was actually pointing out this point. And Turing is famous for the Turing machine, which is supposed to be, and it is at the basis of symbolic processing-based computation science. No, but it was very, since he was a deep thinker, he really already saw this issue. So, and it says, presumably the child's brain is something like a notebook as one buys it from the stationer. Radar little mechanism, a lot of blank sheets. So the idea is that we should, it's why we started from the swan. No? There are probably some very small rules, but very simple rules, which can account for the development. And in fact, it says, our hope is that there is so little mechanism in the child brain that something like it can be easily programmed. You know, that was, Turing was very optimistic about the possibility to build an artificial intelligence. The amount of work in the education we can assume as a first approximation to be much the same as the human child. And this could be seen as a bad news, no? Because so growing an intelligent machine could require years. Actually, we know very somehow, and sometimes intelligent machines which requires 20-25 years to mature, no? To become to have a nice characteristics that we want to put into the software. In weeks or even months or years. So the and this calls for the developmental approach. And we one of the very first lecture was, for instance, from Plymouth, and it was about how to try to put this into a baby robot, which has a limit. The limit of this baby robot is that the physical structure of a baby is fixed and 2.5 or 3 years of age, while the real baby will arrive there after 3 years. So this coordination, mutual adaptation between the body development, physical change, and so the introduction of new sensor, more sophistication, new muscles, so possibility to do things that before I couldn't do, is something which go together and in end with the possibility of having of controlling this arm and to understand what I see around. No? So this is a complexity that you will see, for instance, from you have seen from Minoru Sazada's, from Sazada's presentation, and you will see today in Kuniyoshi, and freezing the body is what they do at the IIT, and what Mehta will be talking about. So maybe I don't know if someone I gave you the answer, so it should be. Somehow, maybe someone wants to try to give to separate. So, what is different between learning and development? Because I mix the two words. No? Someone wants to do a guess? Maybe, yeah. Difference between learning and the development. So I mean, it's legal to make make errors. There are no errors because we are talking about definitions. No? But, say if you what I was pointing out before is that. Learning is the process by which I build a representation of the environment, which doesn't imply necessarily that I change my structure. While development is the process by a child is 1 meter tall, and after some time is 2 meter tall, or 1.5 meter tall. And what we are saying is that the process by which the child learn to move the arm is actually completely, at least, synchronous with the process of the growth of this same arm. So it's not the same thing. When we build an artificial system, for instance, by tradition, now it's different. But by tradition, we use it to distinguish these two things. In fact, most robots are designed, let's say, the iCub is a baby robot. Other robots are baby robots. The Minoru Asada showed some baby robots. Asimo is an adult robot. No? So and then we put the learning on it. The fact that we don't have this development could be an issue. By the way, in terms of modeling and in terms of understanding what's our synthetic methodology to understand the process, you will see that what Professor Bonga is going to show in a while is actually a good model of this kind of this evolution of a morphology. Actually, Bonga will show how you can, in some sense, simulate a simplified evolution in a simplified environment. And so this is the point. We need to if you really want to be take inspiration from nature, we for instance, have to do this kind of exercise. For instance, it means that some of the stages of the development will be simulated, because I cannot build. You see the limits coming from materials. It's very difficult to grow a robot. We still have a technological limitation. So what you can do is to build a 2 years old robot, a 3 years old robot, a 5 years old robot, and in the middle simulate, and before simulate. This is what you can think to do. You can do with the current method. No? So and this was. It's another way to say what I was saying until now. So we think that the learning process based on what? On the sensory flow from the exterior and from the interior of a growing structure is what allows to get rid of a frame of reference issue. So I will put the system, while it grows by learning, will put the labels on the things, on the door. And again, the example that we got on the color by Origan a couple of times ago is in this direction. So the color is something which is good to organize the visual information that you get about the interaction of objects with light. I don't know. People may be more involved already in some research know that the typical problem that we have with vision system in the outdoor is that you need to do a lot of fine tuning because the range of frequency of the red in the morning is not the same when you have shadows or in the night or when it is cloudy or sunny. This is something an embodied approach based on the organization of a sensory stimulation actually is not prone to this kind of error. The problem is that most people working on these things is still not many people have pushed this approach to the level of complexity of an Asimo. And that's why I say we are talking about a research program for the next decade. These are new ideas for doing new things that so far are not possible. And we saw a small example of what I'm going to do. Where mathematics come from lack of Nunez is what I was quoting just a while before. So the fact that actually our mathematical intuition is based in some physical metaphor. I say going to the limit, what will most of the times happen in my brain is that I activate the working control part of my brain, even if I'm static, and I write this long line. Where if you check in the repository, we will find a lecture from Nunez, which is one of the Chuko authors. Well, it's really funny because you see many mathematics professors on the blackboard, and you really understand that they are moving in the calculus, in the function space. And if you do some introspection, you may notice that you also do it. No, so it's not true that. So it's not true. There are good arguments to think that high-level symbolic reasoning comes from the sensory motor stimulation, because it seems that at least humans, we don't know about other entity that we have not met so far. No, we don't know if the replicants will think the same way. No? You know that the original title of Blade Runner was the android dream of electric ships, was in short. So we don't know. A really artificial intelligence would probably have a representation of reality at least slightly different from ours. And now it comes to, since at least two of the presentation of today will be about humanoids, and since I'm more or less pushing that if I want to be, so I'm saying that if you really want to build an artificial intelligence, probably you need not only a humanoid body, but a full development of different stages of a humanoid body. You know? So this is what sometimes I'm trying to say. And this last comment, no? So let's think that I design a completely Roomba, a really intelligent Roomba, no? With eyes, complex interaction. Would this really intelligent Roomba see the world as I see? Can we really communicate with a Roomba, no? With this super Roomba? It is possible, but it's also possible that the way it uses to represent the reality is different. So maybe should I use humanoids to study intelligence, and in particular learning and development? And this is a question that I would pushing the general floor, hoping that you want to try to say something. So I mean, see this as a coffee machine discussion on humanoids. So you see from this if in particular from this perspective, is useful to study humanoids, because it seems useless, no? I mean, the vacuum clear is completely different for, it's not a humanoid. No. Or the car driving, you may have noticed the DRC challenge, you know, where you have these robots going on the Jeep and driving it. Why not just use a self-driving Jeep, you may ask. So any idea about this? Any idea about this? So why it would be useful to use so the benefits of studying humanoids robots, which could be a waste of money, you know, because a humanoid is for sure more complicated than an assistive arm. So I could use the money for the humanoids to develop assistive arm. Why I should waste the money from the point of view of a parsimonious research manager? Any question? Maybe from people working in humanoids? So, any guess? Oh, OK. maybe you don't dare to try because I somehow I told already, no? So the idea is that mimicking, if I want a human-like intelligence, probably I also need a human-like structure. You can discuss about this, but it makes some sense. The problem, of course, are the problems that I was quoting just before. So I should build several physical structures and simulate what happens in the middle. So it's possible that there are also some more basic principles at work that I can study with simpler things. I mean, someone who is polemic on the idea of already studying humanoid says, why you don't study Antoid robots or Spideroid, which are already very complex and are already probably something that we don't know how to build properly. No? So it depends on what you are studying. But now let's see to an humanoid that I introduced as a kind of a wind tunnel for studying cognition, and we can see a baby humanoid. So you also understand that the grounding of this kind of research, for instance, the ICAB, are really deep. They have deep roots, no? Because Turing, thinking abstractly on the problem of how to implement intelligence, was already thinking to the ICAB, for instance. I put the ICAB because there are similar projects, for instance, in Japan. No? We have seen something already, and we will today see something again. So, but you see that even if you cannot have a growing baby, you can do something. So, and this is another point, because you don't do everything every time. So if you start your research, for instance, or as a PhD student or a master student, you will never think that in 2 years you will solve all the problem of the world. So it makes sense, for instance, studying attention, to use a structure which is similar to a baby, and to develop the behaviors with a learning process. So in this case, we have detached. Now it's like having 2 dimensions, the learning and development. I fix the development axis, and I move on the learning axis. Another thing that I can do is to block the learning and move on the development. I hope that Josh will forgive me if I say that it's something similar to some other thing that Josh does. No? So you focus on the development and you leave fix the learning. What happens in reality is that we move along this medium line. And Lakoff and Lunyets would say that in this moment I'm moving on this on this abstract flow, and probably I have some center in my brain which is usually working when I do this kind of exercise. So I move on the diagonal of this room, and it is working like if I were moving on the diagonal of this room. Probably this is the lack of Nunez hypothesis. No? Why I'm actually thinking abstractly. Yeah. And the other idea is that when you listen to this idea, what I'm saying is quite very possible, according to the mirror neurons hypothesis, that we are doing the same thing. You are also working on this line, in this abstract room. No? Just to... Now, since I feel that today you are not very reactive, and I hope that you will keep the questions for the comment are this kind of, so it's a kind of snapshot of so the body is fixed and I study the learning of another direction. And okay, so since I'm running a bit short of time, I don't elaborate too much, but you have many sensor channels that in natural intelligent beings that are physical and also alive, are actually, we have haptics, we have sound, we have vision, actually we have binocular vision, so we have a lot of redundancy in the sensory channels. ICAB has another limit with respect to a real baby. It is rigid, no? Meaning that it has a multi, it's a rigid structure, while baby are soft by definition, almost by definition, actually. No? And so, we even keeping the physical structure fixed in terms of development. We also, when we learn, for instance, to play tennis, we also grow the muscles, not only the way to push the ball with a ratchet. No? So there is also a near now, in terms of a time perspective, aspect in the physical adaptation in the learning. So can I at least try to do that, since I cannot grow the baby robot? An answer to this was actually the robot Etche, from which was came from a big project. Actually, was designed by Rob Knight and other people, and actually was developed according to this idea. And actually, the AI lab of the University of Zurich was involved in this very. So you see that this is quite different from the other robots that you see. Right? Because it is completely tendon driven. You may imagine where, and now maybe Nathan can show the video. So you may imagine where what's the price for building such a cool robot. Is here you see some of the parts. Is that the control, according to current approaches, is a nightmare. So, because you really need an orchestration control framework to be able to manage such a structure. But this is what really, so it doesn't grow, but at least they could be able to simulate the here and now of, and it is very cheap. Comparatively very cheap, because all the materials that they used are plastic material. The process to build it are very, as you see from the video, are very not very sophisticated. So manual random processes. No, so it's a very so this I would say it's kind of a state of the art in this direction. Then always in this is a project from Zurich, no, from AI lab, so Rolf's lab, this Roboy platform, which is a bit more structured of it, no, because if you look, it's more symmetric, has been designed in more classical engineering way. But it is still in the same direction of research. So I try to conclude on this topic. So the main idea should by now be clear. We think that symbols emerge from different flows of time series coming from the sensory stimulation and the interaction. So a lot of this sensory stimulation comes from the fact that I move. If I don't move ahead, I will never have the sensory stimulation coming from the student in the last row on my left. No? So I need to, now I see him. But before I couldn't. And also, even in approaches based on more classical mixture of symbolic processing of a multi-rigid body and using some machine learning, which is probabilistic methods for learning, actually, if you think to the presentation from Professor Krajic, they also, in that case, moving the objects allows to have a better understanding of what you have in front of you. So it's a kind of general. we have several problems in this direction, open problems. And why I talk about a research program. We have a problem as how I simplify all these many tendons, the control of these many tendons, as the massive flow of sensory stimulation, which means long time series of matrices. How I get rid of all this mess and I abstract a chair. Because I have fun following Dennett's example of a robot playing with the bombs, of the fact that, okay, red chairs, and then you have blue chairs, and then you have tall chairs, and then you can sit on the desk, but at some point it's functionally a chair. But also on our side there are many problems. For instance, how I abstract a few small things from this enormous amount of data. And how I really, where I take the models to exploit the morphological computation, how I control a cockroach where most of the physical working is actually coming from a physical structure, and I have a very, think to Kruse example of a insect walking. Yes, very nice, but how I can create an adaptive control for that? How my system, the baby as it grows, acquires its body schema? This research opportunity means this is, if you have an idea, thanks. No? So I'm joking, no? But we have ideas, we are showing ideas. But this means that there is a lot of work to be done before having results. So the idea showing something that before was not shown. Everything can compute. This is the basic idea of morphological computation. But how intelligence and meaning emerge from the synchronization of different intelligence entity? No? Because we assume that our understanding is all in our brain, but actually from a very early stage we are in strict interaction with our mother first, and then with people, adults surrounding us. So it's difficult to say. So we have some issue, for instance, how we quantify the morphological computation, how this happens in a software system, how really we can structure this emergence of intelligence of meaning. So we have some idea. No, we showed these attractors in puppy, for instance, or the example made by on numbers in Plymouth, or those on field, and others that we are going to see later on. But it's the beginning on a road, very promising, because all these experiences seem to confirm the intuition. But so we have approaches. We have approaches which are engineering approaches, like artificial neural networks or deep learning approach, which are, if you want, a very sophisticated approach to neural networks, which have proved extremely successful in implementing real-world linear system. We have information theory in the abstract sense, the one from which we get the predictive information, things like that. And we have network physics, if you want to study complex multi-agent systems. And we have the challenge of integrating the different time scales, like you see here. So if you look at the kind of reaction that you have on different time scales, this is a different approach. Now, before I saw, my learning is at evolutionary stage during my own development, and now I'm learning something. For instance, I notice where is the mouse. That could be in another place, and so I can move it. No, here now. And if you look at this kind of reaction times, so you will see that you use knowledge that has been evolved at different time scales. And here we quickly you can. So we have to merge all these things, no? And in this way, no, in the Swiss robot example, no, that you find in the book, quoted in the book, you see how changing the environment change the behaviors in a surprising way. You have other examples like that of a self-assembled bicycle in a colloid solution. And we have a lot of emerging social behavior in our society, you know, from the wave in the stadium then, or to the beehive, termites, open source community is kind of... recently, this year, I was publishing a very interesting paper from my standpoint, model based essentially on scaling, on network modeling, not network, network, what I call the network fixing, not network science. Someone used to explain how the city grows. No? You know, the city you may imagine which city is depicted in the picture. No? So, it gives it's the one which gives us the name to the lecture. No? So, for instance, it's been proved that there are growth processes that comes from the small, so that you can, to a certain extent, predict the characteristics of a city from the characteristics of local characteristics in how it grows, no? Very similar to the swarm. So the city is a kind of organized swarm. And the model used in this case is the model of given by network science. For instance, this is when I say that this is not humanoid, no, it's what Josh is going to talk later in this part. But actually, you can, if you simplify the world, you simplify the agent, you can show something about how behavior and, for instance, how a system can evolve and at the same time evolve some behavior like locomotion and pushing. For instance, to push something, you need to have a minimum physical structure, but you will see. So we have told many times, you know, what's happening in the real world is that you have many, many variables to cope with. And changing in very, very complex ways. So, and this is what led to the bounded rationality concept by Simons that we quoted already. So, without, for time reasons, entering too much in details, what we will need, and also because we already introduced them, what we really need to define to have a design system, principle at different level, at the level of arbiter, at the level of the agent, at the level of how we design the development, and at the level of how we design the evolution. So, which are the three levels of the three time scales that I quoted at the beginning today. So, the here and now, so the learning, how I learn, where is the mouse on this desk. The learning, ontogenetic learning, which lead me to understand that what is a mouse is for and how I can use it. And all the previous evolution, which makes me enabled to learn this kind of things, no? Because, for instance, a dolphin can learn many other interesting things, but very difficult. It's not the structure to move a mouse in this way. No? So, and so we may elaborate more on this, but I think that it is enough as a carry-on message to this idea of a time scale. And this idea of the fact that learning and development are actually co-evolve, and they co-evolve at the different time scales. And so, and that's all for today. And I see that I am late, so maybe we can have a few minutes break, and then we can have a presentation from Josh Borg.
Tired.
So I can finish for today, and I invite you to the next and final lecture, which is will be some kind of summary lecture, where we'll kind to put together all the different threads on this lecture series, which and we will have Rolf giving the summary. Yes. And okay, thank you so much. Thank you everybody for attending, and thank you again. Okay, bye bye.